Welcome to the Science for the Public lecture series. Science for the Public is an organization committed to bringing science information and issues to the general public. Visit our website for our program listings and blog. Good evening, I'm Yvonne Stapp for Science for the Public, and I welcome you to Contemporary Science Issues and Innovations. Tonight, we take a look at a group of phytoplankton organisms, the foundation of marine ecosystems. Our very special guest is Chris Bowler, the CNRS Director of Research at the Institut of Biologie at the L'École Normale Supérieure in Paris. And since these are two prestigious French institutions that are not familiar to Americans, Dr. Bowler will tell us about them later in tonight's program. Dr. Bowler is a scientific coordinator of the Tara Oceans Expedition, which is providing a global analysis of plankton at a time when climate change and marine environmental threats are causing rapid extinctions and ecosystem breakdowns in the world's oceans. Dr. Bowler's project has provided the most complete picture to date of plankton species, diversity, and function. And we're about to hear just how the team unravels the long genetic history of phytoplankton to understand gene function and to help predict the future of plankton adaptation in rapidly changing ocean environments. Dr. Bowler is a member of the European Molecular Biology Organization. His awards include a silver medal from the CNRS and a foundation Grand Prix from the Institut de France in 2015. Again, we'll get some explanation of that later. It's sort of like the Nobel in France. This year, he's a grass fellow at the Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Research at Harvard and has very generously agreed to talk with us tonight about his work. We are very honored to welcome Dr. Chris Bowler. Welcome, sir.
Beautiful to be here.
Thank you. And I'll ask you, I don't know if people are familiar so much with phytoplankton, but they're kind of important. Can you tell us something general about them? What do they do in the ocean ecosystem?
Phytoplankton are part of the planktonic world of organisms that live in the ocean. Plankton are defined as organisms that drift sort of randomly with the currents. They tend to be microscopic, or at least not much more than a few millimeters in size. So most of the time you need a microscope to see them. When you look down a microscope at a sort of standard average drop of seawater, you see that it's actually teeming with life. And there are all kinds of organisms in there. So there are phytoplankton, which are the photosynthetic organisms in the plankton. They're sort of the equivalent of the plants on land, but they're single cell, they're microscopic, so we don't really think of them as plants, as photosynthesizing, even though they are just as important as the plants on land. So we have these organisms which take energy from the sunlight, they take carbon dioxide, and they produce organic carbon, just like plants do. And then that organic carbon, it can go up the food chain towards the zooplankton, which are the little animals, the little critters, which eat phytoplankton. They can then get eaten by fish, which then get eaten by us. And so this primary production from the ocean phytoplankton will eventually get up all the way to the food chain to us. Then, in addition to going up the food chain, the carbon from the phytoplankton can also go down the food chain, so it can be degraded by microbes, bacteria, typically, which then degrade the material and then release carbon dioxide back up into the atmosphere. Or that carbon can also go down to the bottom of the ocean, where it can stay for thousands, hundreds of thousands of years. So in addition, you have the bacteria that are very important in the planktonic world. And then even smaller than the bacteria, we've got viruses. We've got lots and lots and lots of viruses in the ocean. And they're not dangerous for us, but they infect the other planktonic organisms, okay? This is what they do. They sort of lubricate the ecosystem, mm-hmm. the viruses, together with other organisms that are parasitic, that are pathogenic. They sort of ensure that the ecosystem turns over mm-hmm. to ensure that excesses are not tolerated in the marine microscopic world. All right.
So they have this balance.
There's so they have this balance,
balancing function,
yeah, which
in this foundation level.
The ecosystem is robust. It works. Yeah. It can resist change. Right.
Yeah.
Thanks to this balance of organisms, each participating in the global common good, if you like, of the ecosystem world. So if you add up all of these organisms together, they represent at least 50% of the biomass in the ocean, probably quite a lot more than that. So the other stuff that you see on TV, you know, the sharks, the whales, the dolphins,
the stuff we can see,
that's a pretty small fraction of the biomass in the ocean. And the majority is this microscopic life forms.
But these larger creatures, these more complex creatures, would they survive if you didn't have the phytoplankton level?
No, absolutely not.
Okay,
because
so
they,
this is the
they
foundation.
Photosynthesize, they generate the material which the other organisms eat. And so without them, there would be no food chain. They're the base of the food chain. Without them, there would be no food chain because the energy cannot get up to the larger organisms.
Plus that carbon.
Plus the carbon from through photosynthesis, just like plants, they take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, so they buffer us against the greenhouse gas effects of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Without phytoplankton, the levels of carbon dioxide would be much higher in the atmosphere now, so they have a very, very important buffering effect against climate change induced by carbon dioxide. And then they also, through photosynthesis, generate oxygen, which is the lung of the ocean, which provides the oxygen for the zooplankton.
They really keep the ocean alive.
Absolutely.
They are we understand there are all kinds of these phytoplankton, and you have sort of specialized on one type, but can you tell us something about the variety and then the diatoms in particular that you worked on?
Right. So indeed, there are many, many different kinds of phytoplankton. The diatoms are considered to be the most important group of phytoplankton. That may not necessarily be true. We know quite a lot about diatoms because they're bigger than the other kinds of phytoplankton. And the more we dig, the more we sort of learn about other kinds of phytoplankton, and they seem to be pretty important as well. There are kinds of green algae that are very important in the ocean that we're just learning about now, that are small, but they seem to, you know, be pretty good at photosynthesizing.
Yeah.
And there are other organisms like dinoflagellates, which are also big, like diatoms, but they're a little bit different to diatoms in that dinoflagellates are what we call mixotrophs. So whereas diatoms are like plants, they have to photosynthesize, they need light to grow and divide. If there isn't light, they can't do anything. The dinoflagellates, when there's no light, they just switch to heterotrophy, meaning they start eating sugars and whatever's in the environment. So the dinoflagellates sort of have the best of both worlds. They can stick their chloroplasts out and photosynthesize when there's light and when conditions are not good. They can eat, they can parasitize other organisms, they can live in a completely different lifestyle. And that's something else that also we don't really know very much about in the ocean.
Like super adaptation there, that a real
talent it's a new kind of life. You can think of them as plantimals, you know, half plants, half animals sort of thing. And they seem able to switch, you know, in ways that we don't really understand very well.
That is quite interesting. And now the diatoms themselves, that's your area, I think, of particular expertise. That's what you're quite famous for. Why diatoms then? Can you, what's so important about them?
So as I say, the diatoms are considered to be the most important group of phytoplankton. They are believed to contribute something like 40% of the photosynthesis in the ocean.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so that carbon per carbon makes them equivalent to all of the tropical rainforests on land. The Amazon, the Congo, in Malaysia, add up all of those rainforests and you've got the equivalent of the role of diatoms in the ocean.
That is amazing.
So that's incredibly obviously important. They're incredibly important these days, although they rose to dominance relatively late. You know, they came sort of after the dinosaurs had gone extinct, was when they started to really explode in abundance. So they're relatively latecomers, and we're curious to know why that is. One of the things that they do, which is quite unique to them, is that they use silica. They can take silica out of the environment and they can build their cell walls out of silica, which is glass.
Yes.
So they have this hard covering like glass around the cells, which probably protects them from grazers, from being eaten, protects them from pathogens possibly. And so they're able to mold silica in ways which we human beings are not able to do. You know, anything that we build out of silica, we need high temperatures, high pressures.
Yeah, right.
And diatoms just do it every day of the year, you know, in the ocean. It takes them a few minutes to build a new cell wall. They're beautiful, elaborate nanometer scale structures, which, you know, if one day we can learn how to do that ourselves, that can be useful for all kinds of applications in nanotechnology, in biomedical research, and so on. So that's one interest.
Yeah. On that, if I can interrupt are there other of these microorganisms that use silicon like that?
There are some other more ancient organisms called radiolarians.
I thought that was
which
really,
are not photosynthetic, and they've been using silica for maybe 800 million years or so, whereas the diatoms are, let's say, 100 million years. And it seems that sort of the diatoms are slowly taking over from the radiolarians, okay? But otherwise, utilization of silica is fairly unusual in nature. Some grasses can do it, but otherwise it's fairly rare. But it's silica is a very interesting material because it's tough, it's flexible, and you know, perhaps somewhere else in the universe there is life that is based around silica rather than, for example, calcium carbonate, of which our bones are built.
Right. You
know? I think in the movie Alien, the alien was built of a silica skeleton.
Right. I know that there's a lot of speculation on that elsewhere you could have a life forms based on silica. That's really interesting.
The very important thing about the silica cell wall of the diatoms is that because it's made of silica, it's heavy. So when diatoms die, they tend to sink to the bottom of the ocean. And sinking to the bottom of the ocean, they take the carbon with them that they have photosynthesized, And this is called the biological carbon pump. And it is perhaps the most important biological process whereby carbon dioxide is taken out of the carbon cycle. Mm-hmm. And sequestered away at the bottom of the ocean for thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of years. And ultimately that generates our fossil fuels. Our gas and our oil reserves are plankton, which have sunk to the bottom of the ocean over millions of years.
Yeah.
And so that is an incredibly important process, which really ensures the well-being of the Earth's system. Which is carried out by the diatoms in the ocean.
That's really an addition to this foundation for the ecosystems. In the marine ecosystems, there's this other factor.
Right.
So they're amazing that they can do that. Now, you investigate these little creatures. How difficult is that? And how do you proceed? How do you do this? Examine these creatures. You said that's still fairly new.
Yes. On one side, we have oceanographic cruisers. We go out and we sample, we collect, and we try to understand what's happening in the ocean.
And yours is one of the big ones.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which many people do that, right? Woods Hole, Scripps, institutions that are extremely good at doing that sort of thing.
Yes.
What is also important is to bring these organisms into the lab and use sort of the latest techniques in biomedical research to manipulate them. So like a diatom on average has about 10,000 genes. Most of them we don't know what they do because they're diatom specific. So to learn what they do, we have to knock them out. We have to inactivate them And we can do that using like CRISPR technologies,
which
have been adapted to other organisms. We exploit those techniques from biomedical research, from other experimental organisms like Arabidopsis, like Drosophila. And we use those techniques to explore the function of genes in diatoms in the lab. And so then we get an idea out of these 10,000 genes. We can say, okay, that gene is very important in nutrient uptake or something. And then from those studies in the lab, we can then go back out into the ocean and ask, well, is that gene that we found in the lab really important in the real world?
Yeah,
with or not?
Yes.
And sometimes it is, and sometimes it isn't.
I see. Is isolation, you mean, versus is within the system. The other thing is there, you go in not just one little location in one ocean, you go all worldwide. Is there variety? Is there a lot of variety among these?
Absolutely,
and genetic variety?
There is huge variety. Uh-huh. Absolutely, yeah. The ocean is not at all homogeneous.
Yeah.
There are currents that move, that move the organisms along sort of highways in the ocean.
Yeah.
There are other areas like the gyres in the Pacific Ocean,
yeah,
which are relatively, you know, stable structures, poor in nutrients, sort of ocean deserts.
Yeah.
So there are all kinds of, you know, different kinds of ecosystems in the ocean. It's not at all homogeneous. So
right.
It's important to sample, you know, worldwide to get a feel for what's happening. The other time, the ocean, there is only one ocean. There's not five or six
the
like
way
we
that
have
we're
continents,
taught.
Right?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
There's one ocean. So any organism in point A can move to point B in the
so
future.
They can
it may
move.
Take a week.
Okay.
It may take 10,000 years. But everything is connected in the ocean.
But
that is not the case on land.
Uh-huh. They can adapt then if they're in the Pacific or in the Atlantic. They can switch and they
to
won't
some
fall
extent,
apart. Yeah.
To some extent, they can adapt.
Okay. So you have different, you're looking at the genes, and I presume that you're looking at the factors that may affect adaptability and so on. Can you sort them out? Can you say, well, I think this is environment specifically, you know, and this is climate change?
Yes, we try to do that.
Yes.
A lot of what we do is sort of correlative.
Yes,
so
of course,
we find
now
a particular gene in diatoms living up in the Arctic or the Antarctic, and we hypothesize that these are important for adaptation to cold conditions.
Yeah.
So a lot of that is correlative, but in some cases we can also go into the lab and test these sorts of hypotheses and figure things out. We have the feeling that the diatoms do have a remarkable plasticity in their genetic repertoire. They're diploid organisms, so for each gene that they have two copies,
yeah,
of that gene. And normally, you know, what you read in the textbooks is that those two copies, they both do the same thing. You know, we human beings, we're also diploids, so we have two alleles of every gene,
yeah,
and we're taught that they both do the same thing, except in special cases like X chromosome inactivation that determines male females in,
yeah,
mammals. But we're taught that they both do the same thing. In diatoms, it seems that each of those two alleles, they do different things. So one of the allele will work, for example, in cold temperatures, and the other one will work in warm temperatures. So they sort of get two genes for the price of one by this mechanism of adaptation, which maybe gives them an edge over other kinds of phytoplankton.
Right.
In allowing them to survive more harsher conditions and be more adaptable.
I just want to make sure I understand that. Then this is peculiar to diatoms, that they have these alleles that do
yes,
separate
we believe,
things.
Yes, we believe that
that's
it's quite
interesting.
Peculiar. Yes, so it's something which is people are just brushing the surface,
yeah,
on these kinds,
right,
of mechanisms in mammals, in humans, in plants too. And we don't really know the extent yet of this kind of gene regulation system, but diatoms, they seem to do it, you know, half of their genes, you know, are regulated in this way, you know, it's remarkable. And this has never really been observed before.
Okay, so it's not been observed in other organisms.
Not to this extent.
Not like this. And on top of that, they are in evolutionary terms, a little more recent than we would normally think. We think phytoplankton, it's really ancient, but this is a more recent variety here. Yeah. So what an interesting, interesting thing. And then you can sort of, you're learning to distinguish what might relate to climate change and what might be specific environment or whatever. So that's a goal, I guess.
Yes. It is a challenge. Phenomena such as this allele-specific expression, they probably evolved, you know, sort of at the beginning of the diatoms, you know, 100, 200 million years ago. So that doesn't necessarily tell us about climate change over the time period that we might be more interested in. What is more interesting with climate change are sort of to look back over, let's say, the last 50,000 years or so.
Yes.
And over that 50,000 year time period, we have the human activities, human impact on the ocean, really coming strong in the last couple of hundred years since industrialization, which we're interested to study.
Yes.
And then over this 50,000 year time period, we've also had a last glacial maximum.
Yes.
So the Earth went through an ice age during these last 50,000 years. So we would like to learn more about how diatoms have adapted over this sort of 50,000 year time period. But to do that, we need to develop special techniques to study ancient DNA. And for that, we're sort of being inspired by what human evolutionary biologists do to study ancient DNA from Neanderthals and mammoths.
Which is getting better, absolutely amazing.
And you know, they can go back, you know, a million years now,
which is very new.
From a piece of tooth, a piece of bone or something, they can go back a million years or so, and they can plot, you know, human expansion out of Africa and do all kinds of remarkable things. We're not ready to go back a million years yet with diatoms, but we think, you know, perhaps we can go back 50,000 years conservatively.
That far? I was going to say, can you go back 200 or 300 and make any
I think it should be
analysis.
Possible, yes. So, and because the diatoms, when they die, a fraction of them sink to the bottom of the ocean, the seafloor is sort of a plankton cemetery.
Yes.
Okay, and every year, just like tree rings, the plankton forms layers one on top of the other, and so at the end you get this laminated structure, which if you pull out sediment cores using special drilling apparatus, which oceanographers are very, very good at doing, we can pull out this sediment core, we can date it by the layers in there, and then by using these techniques of ancient DNA extraction, we can pull out the DNA from phytoplankton like diatoms. We can match it up with living diatoms in the ocean today, and we can see how genes have changed over 50,000 years, hopefully. So this is sort of what I'm developing with colleagues in Harvard.
It just seems so astounding because these are very tiny things. It's very different from looking at the hominid development and stuff, you know, a tooth here, a bone there.
Yes,
this is really difficult.
Yes.
Does the silica make it any different? Your remains there with the silica as opposed to calcium?
Possibly. We haven't done enough.
Yes, so it's really new.
To really be able to assess that.
I see.
Yeah.
I can't resist asking, I hope it's okay to ask it here. You are very famous for coming up with some other unique feature of diatoms, that urea cycle, which must have shocked the world. Could you tell us about that? What is the urea cycle, and is it okay to ask now?
Absolutely. So this relates to sort of the origins of diatoms as a group of organisms, I would say. It doesn't really tell us too much about climate change you know, shorter timescales. But this was a remarkable finding. I remember it was, you know, one of the few real sort of eureka moments in my scientific career. We had just started sequencing some of the first genome sequences.
Yes.
This was back in 2000, 2001. We got sequences from diatoms from the Joint Genome Institute in California. They sequenced these diatoms for us, and we had what's called an annotation, genome annotation jamboree. So a bunch of experts got together, sat inside a room, closed room with no windows for a week, and we just went through on the computer, gene by gene.
Oh my goodness.
What is
it,
what does it do? And more or less on the first day, a postdoc in my lab was going through sort of genes involved in nitrogen metabolism. Yeah. And he realized that there's a whole urea cycle encoded in diatom genomes, which was a huge surprise for us, because up until then, we consider the urea cycle to be an animal invention.
Right.
It was something that animals had evolved to deal with a protein-rich diet, okay? So the urea cycle is used to metabolize the proteins that we take in from meats and so on.
Right,
and then removes excess nitrogen in a relatively non-toxic form of urea,
right?
And that's what we thought the urea cycle was for. Once we discovered it in diatoms, that moved the evolutionary origin of the urea cycle way back 500 million years earlier.
Isn't that something?
So it's amazing.
What a eureka moment.
And then we had this, you know, this issue of what on earth is a diatom doing with the urea cycle? Because in the ocean, nitrogen is incredibly precious. It's very rare. So when you pull nitrogen out from the environment, if you're a diatom, you're going to want to keep it.
Not
you're not
going
to want to get rid of it. Yeah.
Right.
So then we spent some time figuring out what the urea cycle actually does, using these techniques of gene knockouts and overexpressing genes and seeing what happens and so on. And we basically figured out that the way diatoms do it, they sort of use the urea cycle in reverse, sort of the opposite of what we do. Rather than getting rid of excess nitrogen, they sort of use the urea cycle to store more nitrogen.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. So we were very, very amazed to discover that several years ago, and that was one of the very nice achievements from my lab, thanks to the
with many prizes. It seems like that's the order of thing where you would get a very big prize down the line eventually, because it changes the way you look at biology in a lot of ways, doesn't it? And on top of that the urea cycle in the diatom doesn't work for the same purpose, I guess, is what you're saying, as it does in higher organisms.
Exactly. It's used, the nitrogen that comes into the urea cycle is then channeled out into processes that are absolutely essential for diatom survival, like the silica cell wall, the glass cell wall. There is nitrogen within that silica cell wall, which is made from the urea cycle.
Okay?
So we believe that these are sort of diatom specific innovations.
So if I ask you, well, does this occur in any other of the phytoplankton family? It doesn't.
Not in this way, no.
Right.
No.
Right.
No. And it comes to diatoms thanks to their evolutionary history, which are sort of a combination of plants and animals coming together at the beginning of the origins of diatoms and related organisms. That gave them a genetic toolkit, you know, which is sort of half plant and half animal.
Yeah.
And then from that, they could sort of pick and choose and, you know, maybe take the best genes which were, you know, most useful in a marine setting. And that, together with genes that they brought in from bacteria through horizontal gene transfer, which is also rampant in diatoms, that about 5% of their genes we believe have been acquired from bacteria over evolutionary time.
Yes.
Gives them these sort of metabolic innovations which we don't have, and which plants don't have, and which bacteria don't have.
Right.
But combine them all together and you can do some new metabolisms which, you know, are maybe important for building the silica cell wall and doing other, you know, unique things that diatoms do that, you know, perhaps give them the edge in today's ocean.
And are they unique also in having this, the two things, plant and animal, a kind of merger, plus borrowing from any bacteria they feel like and so on? They're greedy for everything. Are they unique that way?
As far as we know today, yes. But
but
the more we dig, the more we look at the genomes of other organisms, the more we we see that diatoms are perhaps not necessarily the exceptional, but other phytoplankton do similar things as well.
Yes.
So we have a lot to learn, and there's, you know, not enough people working in the field to really make rapid progress.
Right. So in a sense, you have very advanced technology now, but you still need people who are highly trained, I guess, to do this kind of really exciting work. If you want to be closed up in a room and look at the genome,
yeah.
You have to have that capability.
Yeah.
But it's very exciting.
Yeah. And it's hard to do that, you know, because a lot of, you know, the money for basic research goes into, you know, biomedical research, which, you know, which is fair enough. You know, we want to cure diseases.
I know,
we want to
improve
quality of life. Yeah. So, you know, environmental research always sort of comes along, gets second place.
I see.
It's just the way of the world.
I was going to say that this is like a fundamental science area too. Is that correct? And that's your institution. It represents. I'm going to ask about that. But that that is a real problem. Presumably everywhere. We have to come back to this because we talked a little while ago about this. It's a problem in France. It's a problem, very serious problem here, and so on. Well, I want to ask before we get to your institution and so forth, though, what about the implications of these findings for evolution? You've sort of mentioned that, and for other areas of science, maybe, or biology in particular?
I think there are many things that we're learning about diatoms that we can that can inspire us in other ways, in nanotechnology, in perhaps designing new ways of photosynthesis, improving photosynthesis to improve carbon capture.
That's an interesting one, yeah.
For example, I think for me, what is the most important issue is to try to learn more about what these organisms do to help us understand how the ocean actually functions today. How is it able to be the life support system of our planet today? And what is the ocean going to look like in 100 years' time?
Right.
Right? After, you know, the ocean acidifies,
yes,
which is happening.
Quickly.
After the ocean loses its oxygen,
yes,
which is happening.
Quickly.
Temperatures are rising,
yes,
you know, so the ocean is changing.
Radically.
And we need to understand what the ocean is going to look like in 100, in 1,000 years' time to, you know, give us an idea of, you know, well, is it going to continue to provide the life support system for the planet in general? So I think because of that, we considered it was very important to try and get a sort of global picture of what's happening in the ocean. And that is why we launched this Tara Oceans expedition, which is a research project on a sailboat. It's a 110-foot research schooner. It was owned by Sir Peter Blake, the Tara sailboat, the America's Cup winner. He became a UN ambassador when he quit regatta sailing. And he used the boat sort of to promote environmental issues and so on. And then it subsequently passed to Agnès B, which is a fashion company in France. And Agnès, she'd accumulated a personal fortune over the decades in the fashion industry, and she graciously gives money not only to artistic cultural endeavors but also scientific endeavors.
That's unusual.
In particular, lending her boat out to scientists, and this is a 110-foot sailboat. It's adapted to research. We have like 14 people on board, which are half sailors, half scientists. And with this expedition, over 4 years, we went all around the world. We went around the Arctic Circle, and we collected samples in more than 200 locations around the world. And we used these genomic techniques to look at the viruses, to look at the bacteria, to look at the phytoplankton, and to look at the zooplankton. A whole team of us. I'm one of many people involved in this grassroots project. And a couple of years ago, we were very happy we could publish our first results in Science magazine. So we're very happy we got a special issue from Science. We got five papers back to back describing our first foundational results about the state of plankton in the ocean. And that was a wonderful starting point to really now go on and do more.
So
the sorts of things that we discovered were the number of species in the ocean, get an idea of the number of organisms that are actually present in the ocean, the extent of the biodiversity within those different kinds of organisms. Because we have information about bacteria, about viruses, about phytoplankton, zooplankton, in 210 sampling sites around the world, we can put all of that information together in a huge matrix and ask, well, who do you always find with who?
Yes.
And who do you never find with who?
Yes.
So we can build up like the social network of the plankton world to see who interacts with who in the ocean. And that helps us to understand, you know, how these organisms interact with each other. And then it helps us to understand what do they do. So we learn about what they're doing by looking at the interactions between them and looking at genes which are being expressed, which are not being expressed, to try to help us to understand what they do. And then to try to determine sort of why those organisms are in a particular place, in a tropical region or a polar region, we can compare all of that biological data of the organisms that are there with environmental data, which we can pull in from satellite information about temperature, about salinity, other sort of environmental parameters, which we measured also on board the ship during the expedition. And so we can sort of see, well, which organisms are where and try to understand why are they there and what are they doing. So we so we've already made some big surprises from that sort of work. We found a group of organisms which are a group of sort of radiolarians, which you call Collidaria, which are as abundant as zooplankton in the ocean, which people really didn't appreciate how important these organisms are. We also found a group of organisms which are maybe the most the most diverse organisms in the ocean. They're called diplonemids. You've probably never heard of them.
Never heard of them.
No, they're probably parasitic. They're sort of similar to leishmanias, trypanosomes, sorts of things. Before the expedition, we knew of three species. After the expedition, we got 45,000.
Oh my, thousand.
45,000.
Species.
Yeah. Something like that. They're identified molecularly, these species, that just gives you an idea of the diversity of organisms and organisms that we have no clue about.
Right.
There's so much to discover. In terms of the viruses, we have described more than 5,000 different kinds of viruses.
Yeah.
And before the expedition, we knew about 50. So like 99% of what we found is new to science.
Yeah.
Again, so all kinds of opportunities to learn more about how the planktonic world works.
I can see
why
you think you're just beginning.
Yeah.
There are two things here. I would like to underscore that you have done this in a complex setting, that is to say, within the ecosystem, instead of taking, like, you know how they do with E. coli, they drag it off, well, it's a different thing in a lab after a while compared to in a natural environment. You've taken pains to look at these things in their specific
ecosystems.
We really
wanted to do that because that's the natural world. And it is amazing that you see, you know, you discover a gene in the lab which you think is really important, like the urea cycle.
Yeah.
You know, going out into the natural world and seeing, you know, what does the urea cycle do in the natural world, in natural
makes
plankton
a very
communities
big difference. But I, my
fantastic
sense is that this is still a new area where people are putting the complex picture, connecting the dots, is still new. Is part of that due to the fact that you can do big data now? So you've brought in that you have all kinds of ways of getting this data and then you can look at things in a different way. Is that part of it, or is it a mindset?
Yeah, we are absolutely now in the world of big data.
Mm-hmm.
The genomic data set which we published in 2015 was the largest genomic data set on the planet.
You're
in the
kidding.
Universe.
Is that so?
At the time that we published it, it's maybe not the biggest anymore, but it's a huge data set, which is freely available, publicly available. Anybody can use it, can find new genes, can find, you know, maybe cures for cancer, can find new antibiotic resistance genes, can, you know, it's all out there to be discovered, because we know that we can only just skim the surface of interesting things to be discovered in there. So we are in the world of big data. You know, on the one side, we have this DNA-based genomic information, and we want to compare that with data coming from satellites, which are also huge data sets on a global scale, observing the ocean. And we have to combine all of these things together. So yes, we are using, we need big computes, we need big computers that have to crunch
but
all of that
so
data.
I can see why you say that this is, you know, it's getting, you're really like on a frontier in a lot of ways,
frontier.
Although people have been studying this. Mm. We only have a few minutes left, and I really want to get an idea of your institutions, the CNSR and the ENS, I say it that way. These are very prestigious institutions. Can you give us some idea of what they do? Why are they so special?
Well, first of all, the CNRS is a public research institution. It's existed since just after the Second World War. It was created in France, and it is the scientific body in France that manages most of the basic science that happens in the country. It doesn't really do medical research. That's done by another organization. But the CNRS would sort of be the equivalent of the NSF, the National Science Foundation. The difference between the CNRS and the National Science Foundation is that the CNRS also gives salaries, permanent salaries, full-time jobs to the scientists who are lucky enough to get
positions. That must be nice,
And in the past, that was, you know, that was what kept a lot of the science going in France, because people had permanent positions and they could move forward slowly but surely. But these days, you know, just like in the US, you know, the funding for basic research is being cut. Young people are really suffering. Young people are leaving science because they don't really see much of a future in basic science, very sadly. We don't have the biotech companies that you have in the US. For whatever reason, so it's quite frustrating now to do science in France and in Europe in general.
I'm sorry to hear that, because we think, you know, that some of these institutions are really outstanding, and the permanence factor was a big thing. I hope
and
it will turn around.
Sort of changing.
Yes, that's just changing.
And the ENS is the École Normale Supérieure, which is this. It's sort of the French equivalent of Harvard, if you like. So we have this incredibly strong selection for students. So once
and
they
faculty.
Come in, faculty not so much, but the students are really selected for at a very very high level, just like in Harvard.
Right.
And it's very interesting for me to interact with students at Harvard and to compare them with the students that I interact with in Paris.
And what did you
find?
It's
very very interesting.
Are they different?
Intellectually, they're both absolutely up there, both absolutely outstanding. I think, in general, the Harvard students tend to be more excited about moving forward and really doing something new, doing something creative with their lives, which I don't see as much in the French system right now.
It may be because of the situation of
we're in difficult times now, and so so we don't really know how we're going to come through this dark period.
Right.
But I think, you know, it's the creativity of the young people that we have to support, because they're going to lead us through into the future, and they will provide the technologies that we need to deal with climate change, for example, to deal with all
and
these
to understand
pressing
nature,
issues.
How the nature works. That's true, and also since so much work is global now, these huge international teams and so on, that cannot be broken at this point, but it's a question of getting governments apparently all over the world to commit funds to this research and to understand how important it is, long-range research, and surely it will happen in time. We certainly have our difficulties here with that.
I also believe that philanthropic organizations can do a lot. There are some organizations that are already doing a lot.
But
I think, you know, rather than investing in oil, in fossil fuels, you know, as they have done traditionally, it's time for these countries, these foundations to stop that and to move into, you know, funding basic research, in particular with respect to climate, oceans, you know, because these are global issues and, you know, national...
It's obsolete. It's almost tribal, the national idea anymore, because, and it's so true in science and in technology, it's global. That's all there is to it. Even these big corporations, they're global. They almost don't need the state anymore. And there's a mindset around this, but there's a great need to commit funding for this public and maybe private well.
I hope that the philanthropic organizations will step up and help us deal with these global problems that we have to face climate change, to understand how the Earth system works.
Yes.
It's a basic research problem. It transcends the boundaries of physics and chemistry and biology. It's something that we need help to do at an international level. And I hope these philanthropic organizations can step up and help us to do that.
Right. I'm sorry that we're out of time, Dr. Bowler, and I would really love to hear more. Thank you ever so much for giving your time. That was very generous. I know this is a busy year for you. They all are, but this has been particularly busy, perhaps while you're at Radcliffe. Thank you again.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.